Good morning. I want to welcome everybody online as we are here for our Memorial Day service, a service where we honor those who have gone on before us, but also the servicemen and women who gave their lives for our freedoms. But also today we are going to honor our graduates from the church here also this day. Our call to worship as we begin our service is taken from Matthew chapter 14, verses 13 to 14, and we read these words. Now, when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a desolate place by himself. But when the crowds heard of it, they followed him on foot from the towns. Let us pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we come into your presence this day, asking that you will open our hearts and minds to your word, that as we hear your word, that we will understand it and then go out and apply it to our lives each day, that we may live for you and grow in our grace and knowledge of you. Bless this time we have together. We pray this in your name. Amen. We have a couple of announcements to go through and then our graduates to go through also, but and our those who have gone on before us. We will be having in-house worship service next Sunday, May 31st. So we will meet here at the church. The Oaks Presbyterian Church will be at 10 o'clock. We will be at 11. Cogswell will start up sometime in July. And one of the things we do want to stress, and we'll be sending out a letter to everybody so that with all the guidelines that we're going to follow. But one of the things we really want to stress is if you feel uncomfortable coming back to church because of COVID-19, we ask that you stay home then. Or if you're not feeling well, please stay home. But we're still going to live stream our services, so you still will be able to be a part of that service. So this coming week, we will have that letter going out to everybody. And we really stress, please follow the guidelines in there as you come to church next Sunday. We want to honor those who have gone on before us. We're going to put up the names here of the individuals from Memorial Day of 2019 till now, those who have passed on. And I just want to honor those individuals and their families by reading their names. Ruby Eibersbach, Merle Pressler, Earl Eibersbach, June Olson, John Wentworth. From Cogswell, we have Dennis Doctor. And then from the Presbyterian Church, we have Dave Frogen and Jeffrey Rath. To those families, we honor you this day, and we honor the memory of those loved ones. Also, a couple of you have used our online giving, the e-giving that we have, and so please be sure to take a look at that. I think it's a wonderful thing to use, especially over the summer months, and so we just ask that you would, if you want to, please participate in that. Our graduates are graduating today, and I just want to say these words of encouragement to you. God's plan for you is not necessarily your own plan. When things don't go as you'd like, remember that God can bring the victory in any kind of catastrophe. Have faith in God's love for you. That's the true source of our hope. If there's one Bible verse I'd want to share with you as you go into the rest of this summer and then as you go off into college, it would be this passage from Jeremiah 29, verse 11. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you hope and a future. Our hope is not found in our education, in our abilities. Our hope is found in Jesus. And may you continue to follow Jesus as you go off to college. Here is a list of our graduates, and we honor them this day.
Well, I wish I had a short-term memory. Wish the only thing my eyes could see was the future burning bright right in front of me. But I can't stop looking back. Yeah, I wish I was a perfect picture of somebody who's never not good enough. Well, I try to measure up, but I mess it up. And I wish I wasn't like that. I wish I wasn't wishing anymore. Wish I could remember that nobody's keeping score. I'm tired of throwing pennies in a well. I gotta do something. Here goes nothing. Grace reminds me that my best days are not behind me. Wherever my yesterday may find me, well, I don't have to stay there now. See, my hourglass is upside down, and my Sunday soon is here and now. The clock is ticking, and I'm so sick and tired of missing out. I wish I wasn't wishing anymore. Wish I could remember that nobody's keeping score. I'm tired of throwing pennies in a well.
Time of prayer this morning. We especially want to remember our loved ones who have gone on before us, and we also especially want to remember those service men and women who have gave their lives serving our country. Let us bow for prayer. Dear Lord, we remember the many brave men and women who have given their lives through the history of our country to protect us from danger and harm. We remember all those who sustained injury in mind or body in the course of their service. We salute all those who served in the military. And Lord, this weekend, even if we plan fun events for Memorial Day, it's important to stop long enough to bow our heads and pay respect to our departed loved ones. Let us take time to make the pilgrimage to various cemeteries and pause long enough to say, "Thank you, Father, for these special lives, for sacrifices made, and for the friendships we have shared." We come before you, Lord, and we pray these things in the way that you've taught us how to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." There is a hymn that really reminds us, as I said to the graduates, that our hope is, we have a sure foundation, our hope is found in Jesus. And our first song is, "How Firm a Foundation."
How
Our message for today is how to handle stress, or how do we face stress that comes into our lives. And I don't think there's anybody that would argue with this statement that stress has become a significant killer in our society. And it affects many people. For instance, listen to these statistics. 7 out of 10 people feel stressed at some point during their job or during a typical workday. 80% of workers feel stressed on the job. 40% of all job turnovers is stress related. Somewhere between 75 and 90% of all visits to the doctor's office stem from stress. 34% of workers report difficulty in sleeping because they are too stressed out. Stress is now costing American business over $150 billion a year in healthcare costs, lost work time, and poor quality of work. Medical science has shown that stress is now known to be one of the leading causes of heart disease and many other things that affect our bodies, depression, and other mental capacities. Hypertension, chest pains, ulcers, and the list goes on and on and on. In a recent Los Angeles Times article, psychologist Richard Blackman says that pastors are the single most occupational frustrated group in America. And I read this and I really was amazed by this. About 75% of pastors go through a period of stress so great that they consider quitting ministry. And 35% to 40% actually do. The statistics showed that 1,200 ministers leave the ministry every month. What this tells me is that it doesn't matter what profession you are in, it doesn't matter what you are doing in life, stress is something we all face. The phrase that is used during the COVID-19 crisis is, we're all in this together. Well, when it comes to stress, it's the same thing. We are all in this together. Jesus knew about stress. The story we're going to look at is the feeding of the 5,000. And just before this event, John the Baptist had been beheaded. And Jesus, it says, withdrew to a solitary place where he hoped he could be alone. But the great crowds followed him. And we pick up the story in Matthew chapter 14, verse 15. As evening approached, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place and it's getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the village and buy themselves some food." But Jesus said to them, "They do not need to go away. You give them something to eat." The disciples were befuddled. "We only have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, they answered. And he said, "Bring them here to me." And he directed the people to sit down. Now, this is a very familiar story. Hundreds of sermons have been preached upon this subject. I've preached on it many different times myself. Some people will look at this story and say, well, this tells us that whatever we offer to Christ, God can take it and use it. Some will look at the story and say, well, Jesus is the bread of life. He is the one we go to for all of our needs. Some people say that tells us that in our lives we need to share with those around us. And there's all different ways to look at this. I want to look at this a little bit different way. I think in this story we see some rules or some keys on how to handle stress. Because stress is something we face on a weekly basis. And I want to show how this story illustrates how we are to handle stress. But before we get into that, we need to look at the response of the disciples. I love the disciples' response here. Have you ever noticed in many of the stories of the Bible how human the disciples are? disciples often seem frightened, terrified. They are almost always anxious about something. And in this story, they are worried. 5,000 men have shown up. Well, many Bible scholars believe that's just men if you include women and children in there. There's probably anywhere from 20 to 25,000 people. And now it's supper time, and there are no golden arches nearby. There's no restaurant nearby. What will they do? I'm going to ask a question that may seem kind of foolish. Do you worry? Do you get stressed out? Well, if you do, you're right there with the disciples. Count yourselves among them. They were definitely feeling the stress. The disciples were very concerned of what they were going to do. And I think they were concerned because this might not look good for Jesus. Some people might get very upset and angry and go home hungry and never come back again. There was no food, and stress was present. Henry Ward Beecher says that every tomorrow has two handles. We can take hold of it with the handle of anxiety or the handle of faith. So the disciples come to Jesus. We have no bread. They're in turmoil. So how did Jesus handle this stressful situation? Jesus handles the situation with calm. He's very calm about this. The disciples are frantic. And when they say, we only have five loaves of bread and two fish, I don't think that's the way they said it. I think they said, we only have five loaves of bread and two fish. Jesus said, bring them to me. And then Jesus did a very simple thing. In our text it says, he directed the people to sit down. Have you ever noticed in your life what a calming effect just sitting down can do? Sometimes the best advice we can give to people who are stressed out is be still. It's the best advice we can give to ourselves. Be still. In fact, we do have a verse out of Scripture that tells us this. It says, be still and know that I am God. There's a story of a man who was seated by a pond when he accidentally dropped a coin he had in his hand. It was a very valuable coin. It was a rare coin, and it fell into the water, and the water wasn't very deep, and he could see it in the little rocks there. And so he dug around with a stick in there. But the problem was, as he did that, the clouds of dirt came up, and he couldn't see nothing. And he sat there kind of bemoaning the fact, and all of a sudden he looked in the water, and everything was clear, and he could see where the coin was, and he reached down and picked it up. Sometimes the best thing we can do is stop running around frantically and just sit down. And I want to propose not just sit down, but kneel down and compose ourselves by praying to our Heavenly Father. Jesus basically said to the people, okay, to the disciples and the people, okay, hold your horses, sit down, be still. I love a phrase my mother would say once in a while, and all of you have heard this phrase before. She would say to me, stop running around like a chicken with your head cut off. Be still. Stop worrying. Stop running around. Pause. Calm yourself. Kneel down and pray. Well, the second thing Jesus did was not only just told people, be still. But Jesus relied on his Heavenly Father. Matthew chapter 14, we begin with verse 19, taking up the story. Taking the five loaves and the two fish and looking up to heaven, he gave thanks and broke the loaves. Then he gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the people. They all ate and were satisfied, and the disciples picked up 12 basketfuls of broken pieces and that were left over. The number of those who ate was about 5,000 men, besides women and children. I made a comment one time many years ago that the reason there was 12 basketfuls left over is that because it really wasn't fish, it was lutefisk, and nobody wanted to eat it. But when Jesus blessed the loaves and fish, he did not look at the people, he did not look at the disciples, he did not look down at his own hands. It says he looked up. He looked up to his heavenly Father. Stress will always overcome us when we look for help in all the wrong places. When we try to solve things on our own, when we try to have other people solve things for us, our strength fails. Our strength must come from God. And that's why Jesus looked up to heaven. And this was not the only time that Jesus did this. When Jesus' good friend Lazarus passed away, he was at the tomb and he had them rolled away the stone. And Jesus raised his eyes and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me." Notice that he raised his eyes. He looked to God. And then Lazarus was raised from the dead. And there is a passage that I use many times during family services and at funerals. And it's just a wonderful passage. It says a lot about this very same thing. Psalms 121. "I will lift my eyes to the hills. Where does my help come from? It comes from the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth. When eyes are lifted to heaven, stress begins to fail. It begins to fade away." And the third thing we see here about Jesus handled stress, he handled it with companions, with the disciples. We assume that Jesus spent so much of his time with the disciples because he wanted to train them to continue his work after he was gone. But I think Jesus spent a lot of time with the disciples to show them, you need one another, we need each other for friendship and emotional support. The University of Pittsburgh psychologist Thomas Kamak asked 39 college-age women to begin with a number in the thousands. Pick out any number you wanted. Some picked out 1,200, some picked out 1,800. And then he instructed these women to count backwards from, let's say, 1,500 by 17, all the way to zero. And he told them, you need to do this as quickly as possible. Now, he had them hooked up to monitor, to machines that were monitoring their heart rate and everything else. And what he found out was that it was extremely stressful. Heart rates went up, blood pressure went up, everything went up. And then he did the same experiment again, except this time he told each one of them, you can have one of your friends there with you to help you. And when he was looking at the cardiovascular systems, how they responded, everything, because they had a friend there, everything was cut in half. Everything was cut in half. It was not as stressful. This should be no surprise to us. One author puts it this way, the most stressed out people are loners. We need friends to help us to keep from coming unglued. Of course, Jesus' most important companion was his heavenly Father, but also his disciples. I'll never forget the first Sunday I was in this church here, and I've said this before, but it bears repeating, is the very first Sunday we were here, we shook hands and went downstairs into the entryway. Everybody was gone already. Nobody stayed around. And I thought, wait a minute, that's, you know, we need that time to stand around and talk and fellowship. And it was about several months later that all of a sudden people were staying around and talking and fellowshipping. And I kind of joke now, it's kind of hard to get people out the door. I want to go eat. But we need that fellowship because it does help with that stress. Because from one another, not only from our Heavenly Father as we lift our eyes to the hills, but as we look to each other, we can get encouragement and help and guidance and support. So Jesus shows us these three ways to handle stress from the feeding of the 5,000. Number one, stop running around like a chicken with its head cut off. Be still. And know that God is God. Secondly, lift your eyes to the one who will help. Not everything else around you, but turn to God immediately. And then stay in fellowship with other believers. Seek advice. Seek that encouragement. And be willing, as a believer, be willing to give that encouragement to those around us. We will not keep stress out of our lives. But it will not control or rule our life either. Let us pray. And gracious Heavenly Father, we ask that as we go on in this coming week, there will be times when we do feel stressed out. Times when we're just running around wondering what we are going to do. And yet we know that as we lift our eyes to the hills, you are the one. You are the one who brings that help that we need. May we each day take those moments when we feel that stress coming in, just to be still and lift our eyes to you. We pray this in your name. Amen. Our closing hymn is a really wonderful hymn that reminds us of where our help comes from, and God will never fail us. And it's 'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus. Please join with me in our benediction. Gracious Heavenly Father, as we go out in this coming weekend, we just ask that we will pause and give thanks and remember those servicemen and women who gave their lives so that we can enjoy the freedoms that we have. May we also pause and remember those loved ones who have gone on before us, and may we remember their example of faith and follow that example. And then for the graduates, Father, we just pray that you will be with them over these summer months, watch over them, guide them. Then as they go off to college or whatever they're going to do, Father, be with them each step of the way, and may they have their faith, hope, and trust in you each day. Go with us now. Guide us in all things. We pray this in your name. Amen. We will see you next week online and hopefully here at the church. Amen.